Father, it's me. Please hear me, my King. I know I am unholy, so unworthy and unclean, but I yearn to know you. I so thirst for you. And my temple is broken, it's broken down. Take me and make me new, yeah. Oh, Father,
Father,
hear me,
hear me.
God rules.
God rules.
I'm not asking for blessings, not your hand, Lord, but to know your heart. So show me,
show me
the way. Without you, Father,
without you.
Oh, I'm patiently waiting,
waiting.
Oh, for you, Lord. To take me and make me know.
Take me.
Hallelujah.
Make me new.
Take me, Lord.
Take
yeah.
Me.
Hallelujah.
Make me new.
Take
me,
Lord.
Take me new.
Hallelujah.
Take me.
Make me your. Corey Williams, everybody.
Father, it's me, humbly on my knees. I know I am unworthy, unholy, and unclean, but I long to know you. My soul thirsts for you. My temple is broken down. Oh, take me and make me new. Asking for blessings anymore, not your hand, Lord, but to know
your heart.
Show me
the way,
without you,
Lord,
I'm patiently waiting
for you.
Take me and make me new. Wash my head, 'cause I wanna worship you. I wanna worship you. Here we are. Here I stand. So make me new. Make me new. Make me new. Say, wash my heart. Wash my heart.
Wash my heart.
Lord, wash my head. Wash my heart, wash my hands, 'cause I wanna worship you. I wanna worship you. Here we are, here I stand. Everybody say, make me know, yeah.
We say greetings to all the beautiful people of the Lord on tonight. We thank the Lord for, amen, being able to be back in the household of worship one more time. Amen. We are very, very grateful unto the Lord for his keeping power, his strength, amen, that he has blessed us with throughout the entirety of this week. Amen. And we thank the Lord for traveling mercies and for his ability, all-knowing, knows how to do what to do, when to do it. Amen. It's good to be alive. It is. It really is. It's good to be alive. Amen. We can complain about this, that, and the other if we desire to, but it is simply good to be alive. Amen. And we are grateful to all of God's people. Amen. From near and far to our united family, we salute you in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And we are very grateful, amen, to all of you. Amen. We thank God for, amen, consecration on this week. Thank God for prayer. Amen. We thank the Lord for meeting us in the prayer room, being able to touch and to agree, and seeing the power of the Lord, amen, moving. And I believe that through prayer, God is still performing miracles. He sets miracles, signs, and wonders. Signs and wonders will follow them that believe, them that believe. And so tonight, amen, we're just grateful to be believers in him. Acts 26 and round about verse 22, it says, having therefore obtained help of God, we continue unto this day, witnessing both to small and to great, saying none other things than the prophets and Moses said should come. And so we're grateful, amen, to have the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ, holding on to the truth of God, to the word of the Lord. Amen. So, amen. We do honor our beloved presiding bishop, amen, Bishop James B. Thornton, to Elder Travis, and to all of our deacons, all the precious people of the Lord. Amen. We're grateful to you all in Jesus' name, to all the wives, and even to my wife on tonight. We thank God for you in Jesus' name. All right. And so tonight, by the grace of God, we're going to endeavor to get right into our lesson, our study, in the name of Jesus. And won't be too lengthy on tonight, but we'll go through a few passages of scripture and discuss them briefly in the name of the Lord. So by the grace of God, as we discuss, we're going to attempt to go through the book of Romans, amen, from chapter to chapter. And quite naturally, as in any other study, there are some pieces in there that we will skip through, skedaddle through, and some pieces we will dive a little deeper into in the name of the Lord. And again, if there are any questions that someone may have, they can write them in the chat, and then we will address them accordingly in Jesus' precious name. And so let's pray in the name of the Lord, and then we're going to get right into our lesson on tonight. Father, we thank you. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy. Thank you for grace. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. You've been so kind and so good to us, even when we thought we would go astray, when we felt moments in our life like throwing in a towel. You've always allowed us to be reminded of your word, that we are more than conquerors through you that loved us. And we thank you for loving us, that compelling love that draws us, that love that pulls us closer, that love, the love of God, the purity of your love, true love, honest love, unfeigned love. We thank you tonight, love without hypocrisy. You are genuine love, and we ask you tonight that you would fill us in our entirety with your love, that we can love like you, that we can be like you, walk like you, talk like you, speak like the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord, we thank you. We pray even now that you would bless every heart. We pray that you would bless the viewers. In the name of the Lord, we pray that you would bless the entirety of this study. Bless us, Lord. Keep us, preserve us, touch us, deliver us from all aspects of evil. We give your name the praise. We give you the glory. It's in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. So we are in the book of Romans and chapter number one. First verse says, "And by the grace of God, here we go. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God." Paul called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. Paul, separated, a servant or a slave, servant or a slave. And some people don't like the word or the terminology to be a slave. Some people say, "Oh, I'm a friend of God." Well, that's true too. But when we're serving him, I'm a servant. You know, it's either you're going to be a slave to the devil or you're going to be a slave to God. That's just what it is. And I want to be obedient, strive to do my best to be obedient to his will. If we fall short of his will, then I want to do what my master has required of me. Therefore, I don't have a problem being called a slave unto the Lord Jesus Christ, a servant, a slave. I'm bound to do what the master has called me to do. And so we should remember that we are all servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul says he was a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, according to the flesh. Now, previously we had asked the body of believers united, those that would partake in it, may not even be a part of United, but we gave a little just brief homework to explain what was being made of the seed of David, being made of the seed of David according to the flesh. So he says, concerning his Son in verse number 3, Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, according to the flesh. So let's go to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. And let's begin at verse number 26. And what really happens here is that the angel foretells of Jesus' birth. All right, Luke 1 and 26. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto the city of Galilee, named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. So they were espoused. They were espoused. She was a virgin. They were espoused. So it's like a betrothed, it's like a engagement. They were not married as of yet. And so the scripture says, to a virgin, verse 27, espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. The angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. The angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. Now you got to really think, that had to be a troublesome thing, that she had to, fear had to come upon her. Even though the angel was speaking to her, that had to be an awesome feeling. And verse 31 says, And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, shall be called the Son of the Highest, the Lord, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? The angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Glory be to God. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God, I love it, nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. So the angel foretells Mary of the son Jesus that is coming. Yet she's a virgin, yet she does not know any man in that configuration. She is untouched. She is pure. She is a virgin. She has never laid down with a man. And so Jesus decides to utilize her, and understanding the relationship with Joseph, because what Jesus is going to do here, he's going to come through a particular lineage. It's going to come, he chooses to come through a particular lineage. All right. Now, if you look at let's go to Isaiah. Isaiah 11. And let's look at verse number 1. He says, "And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, Spirit of wisdom, understanding, Spirit of counsel and might, Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears." That's powerful, because you can't always go by what you see. You can't always go by what you hear. He says, "But with righteousness shall he judge the poor and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faith and faithfulness the girdle, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins." All right. So verse 1 says, "And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, a branch shall grow out of his roots." A branch. All right. So come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse and a branch. All right. Go to Revelations. Revelations 5:5. He says, "And one of the elders saith unto me, Weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David. The Root of David hath prevailed to open the book, to loose the seven seals." So Jesus, who is the Lion of the tribe of Judah, was also known as the Root of David. He's also known as the Root of David. All right. Isaiah says that there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. So we understand that Jesse was David's father. Okay. He says, "A rod shall come out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his," what? "Roots." Now, he says in Revelations 5:5, that Jesus is not only the Lion of the tribe of Judah, but he is the Root of David. Now, let's go to and one verse can send you all over the place, but this is the beauty of the scripture. Let's go to Matthew chapter chapter 1, because while and yet when we talk about the lineage or read the historical set of people's life, where they come from, who the mother, who the father was, who the grandfather was, oftentimes it can be quite boring. It can be quite boring, to be honest and frank. But when you can put certain things together, scripturally wise, it really becomes a beautiful thing. And in chapter 1 in Matthew, it really deals with the lineage, the genealogy of Jesus Christ. And in some of these, you'll get a variation. For example, in Matthew 1:1, it says the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, son of Abraham. Okay, so this one calls him the son of David, but actually then goes all the way back to Abraham. All right, now Abraham begat Isaac, Isaac begat Jacob, Jacob begat, this says Judas, but it's really Judah and his brethren. And it goes on and on. And then in verse 5, it says, and Salmon begat Boaz. Boaz begat Obed, and Obed of Ruth, and Obed begat Jesse, and Jesse begat David the king, and David the king begat Solomon of her that had been the wife of Uriah. Solomon begat Rehoboam, Rehoboam begat Abijah, Abijah, Asa. It goes on to say Asa begat Jehoshaphat. Now, if you skip all the way down to verse number 17, so all of these, this lineage is all kings, all kings, all kings, all kings. It's beautiful. All kings. Catch it. They're all kings. God is blessing. They're all kings. All right. They're leaders. They're kings. Now, listen to watch what happens here. He says, and I'm in verse 16. Joseph begat, and Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who was called Christ. So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14. From David unto the carrying away into Babylon are 14 generations. And from carrying away to Babylon unto Christ is another 14. So 14 times 3, this is where we get the understanding that Jesus Christ himself comes through 42 generations. All right. Now, he destined that to happen. So technically, Jesus comes through a royal bloodline. He comes through a royal bloodline. He comes through a royal bloodline. Jesus is royalty, but he comes through kings. He comes through the bloodline with a purpose. Okay. He is the root, and he's the offspring of David. He's the root and the offspring of David. He's the root as the creator. He's the offspring in the sense of being the blood descendant. Okay? He's the root as the creator, and then he is the offspring as being a blood descendant. It's amazing. David is born before him. King David is born before him, yet he can't operate without the strength of Jesus or of God, because he is the creator, all right? So he's the root And he is the offspring. Glory be to God. So God decides to choose this lineage to come through, and he uses Mary as the mother that he wants to use, a virgin, and he goes around the man, praise the Lord, and the Holy Spirit overshadows her and impregnates her, and 9 months later, she's rocking a baby boy in her arms. His name is Jesus the Christ. Powerful, powerful, powerful. Now, Luke says it just slightly different, but in the same context. Let's just go there. We're in Bible study. Luke chapter 3. Luke chapter 3 and verse number 3 through 23 through 31, you'll get the genealogy of Jesus as well. From verses 23 all the way through 31, again, you will get all of that. How Jesus came through. Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, which was the son of Heli. He says the son of Matta. He says the son of Levi. And then goes on and on and on by the grace of God, which then finds out, he says in verse 38, which was the son of Enos, which was the son of Seth, son of Adam, which was the son of God, goes all the way back. This one goes all the way back to Adam. Luke or Matthew, I told you, he went all the way back to Abraham. Okay. So we find out that as we go back to our original context of our text, he says, made of the seed of David according to the flesh. Jesus Christ, the Son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. So God allowed himself, he restricts himself, because you're talking about the Almighty God who has all power in heaven and in earth. He's all powerful. And sometimes we just look at it, oh well, Jesus was a man. Well, you really have to look at it from a different context, that Jesus is not, he was not any ordinary man. When he was born, he did not have sinful flesh, because when we were born, the scripture says, when we were born in sin, shaping into iniquity, and sin did our mother conceive us. And sin did our mothers, your mother and my mother, they conceived us. Watch this. Even if they were already saved, watch this, because sin nature is still there. Sin nature is well alive, even though we are saved. Okay? All right? We're saved to be saved. Now, so that's why we must be born again. And to continue in the works, to kill them or mortify the deeds that are in this flesh. Now, so in sin did our mother conceive us. So we were born in sin, shaped into iniquity. All right. Now, because we had the blood of Adam through Adam's sin, we inherited the Adamic nature. So Jesus could not come the ordinary trail as we did. So what Jesus decides to do, that's how God is so powerful. He decides that I'm going to come. I'm going to circumvent the man. I'm going to go around the man. I don't need man, okay? Because everyone's sin, everyone's blood, let me say it like this, everyone's blood was tainted from Adam to Abraham to Moses to Isaac to Jacob to David to Uriah. I don't care who we name, all of them were tainted. All of their blood was tainted. So Jesus decides that he's going to come through a royal bloodline, yet, watch this, he comes through a royal bloodline, but uses none of their blood. He comes through the royal bloodline, yet uses none of their blood, like none of it. Glory be to God. And he was able to utilize Mary because she was a virgin. She never knew a man. And then because there was no sexual, there was no intercourse, there was no intercourse between a man and a woman, but there was, how could we say it? There was intercourse in the spirit of where God allowed his will to be provoked and birthed. Okay, so he overshadows the woman, impregnates her, glory be to God, and without the seed of man, for the seed is in the man, but he does not utilize the seed of the man, and the spirit overshadows. So what is inside her, glory be to God, is of the spirit. Comes forth, praise the Lord, all God. When she gives birth, she's giving birth to God. Powerful. No sin, no guilt of sin in his flesh. There's when he's born with power. Glory be to God. When he's born with wisdom. When he's born with strength, but he's a baby. When he's born, he already has everything in his hand, but he needs to be nursed and fed. When he's born, he's God Almighty in the flesh. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. She's holding God in her arms. Therefore, she had one of the greatest things to ever happen to her in her life. The scripture says concerning Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David. And so when we read, that's why in reading sometimes we have to really take our time, because it's a little more in depth than what we actually see. Glory be to God. And so he did all of that to come through a royal bloodline, but use none of their blood to save people like you and I. Glory. Isn't that beautiful? He does all of that for us. All of this for us. How the beautiful God that we serve, that he would do this for us. If you agree, just type that in tonight. He did all of that for me. Glory be to God. He did all of that just for me. All right. Now, let's skedaddle here, because our time is, I can't believe what time it is already. And that's just one verse. All right. So let's just kind of skedaddle here. And then I want to leave you with another assignment tonight. I'm going to leave you with an assignment with some instructions. All right. Now, he says here in verse number 4, and he declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also called of Jesus Christ. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We're still called to be saints. We are still called to be saints. I know he's writing to Rome, to the church, to not to the church, but he's writing to those that are in Rome, but we are called to be saints. I need you to type that in tonight. We are called to be saints, and we never want to forget who we are at the core of it. We are called to be saints. Okay, he says, first I thank my God, I'm in verse 8, I thank my God through Lord Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit. Now, let me back up here real quickly, and then we're going to take off, and we're going to land in verse number 16 by the grace of God. He says, first, I thank my God through the Lord Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of through the whole world. Now, I have this underscored in my Bible. Now, it seems so insignificant, but when it's real faith, he says, your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. When it's real faith, faith is going to be seen, and seeing faith will be heard of eventually. Let me say it again. He says, your faith is spoken of throughout the world. When it's real faith, faith is going to be seen. See, some people talk faith, but to really have faith, you have to walk faith, all right? You can't just talk faith. You got to walk faith, all right? Type that in for me tonight, and we're about to launch and wrap it up real quick here. We cannot just talk faith. We have to walk faith. He says we walk by faith. We walk by faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. So we just can't have talk faith. We have to have walk faith. This faith has to be walking. And when it's a walking faith, not just a talking faith, because sometimes there's a vast difference between talking faith and walking faith, because people can talk something until the scenario hits their home and it shifts their walk. But when you're walking faith, that means that even if I'm put into the lion's den, my faith still says that God is going to shut the mouth. Glory be to God. He's going to shut the mouth of the lion. It's walking faith. It's not just talking faith. It's something that I truly believe. And when I walk in faith, my faith is going to be seen. When my faith is seen, it's going to be eventually heard of, because you know why? Because people are going to talk about it. Glory be to God. They're going to talk about it. People will talk about your testimony. People will talk about your story. People will talk about the revelation of the glory that you're living in, because they now don't just see talking faith, they see walking faith. Let me tell you, I rather see walking faith, because walking faith talks louder than talking faith. Because people talk until the very hour of temptation comes, and then they forget who they really are. They forget in the one that they said they trust. They deny him. Glory be to God. Help me, Holy Ghost. And we never want to be the Christian, the one that's supposed to be God fearing, but we are just talkers. Mm-hmm. He said it like this in one occasion, that they praise me with their lips, but their hearts is far from me. In other words, the connection is not really there. So it's really not a true a turning point of worship. When we have real faith, glory be to God. Ooh, when we have real faith shifts our worship. Real faith shifts our thinking. Real faith shifts our perspective. That even though others may be around and say, that can't be done like that, I don't know why you even believe that, but that's why he says, if you're going to have faith, he says, have it to yourself, because sometimes everybody can't handle the depth of your faith. Everybody can't handle the depth of your faith. So Paul says your faith, he says, I thank Jesus Christ for you all that your faith is spoken throughout the world, throughout the world. And so this is not just talking faith. They had walking faith. Glory be to God. And the walking faith becomes living faith, and the living faith becomes spoken about. And when it's spoken about, people recognize that you have a testimony, and others gravitate to it because we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. You can only have a testimony if you had faith to go through something and come out of it. Glory be to God. I'll say it again. You can only have a testimony if you had faith to go through something and to come out of it. Hallelujah. So it's walking faith that then is living faith, because faith without works is dead. So there's a dead faith and then there's a living faith. If there's a living faith, there has to be a dead faith. Hallelujah. Just type in tonight, I thank God for living faith. Living faith is never stagnant. Living faith carries a testimony. Living faith, hey, glory. Living faith brings forth a song out of Zion. Living faith brings forth worship, hallelujah, when you're in the valley. I say, hey, glory be to God. I said, living faith brings forth a song even when you're in the valley. Hallelujah. When you don't understand, when you're discombobulated, when you're thrown into the state of confusion, when you are mesmerized in a place, hallelujah, and you're just wondering and you feel like you don't know how you're going to make it through. But watch this, because it's living faith. Living faith says it does not become stagnant. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Even though I may not understand what the Lord is doing, but it's not always for me to understand what he's doing for it, but it is for me to trust him in the process. Hallelujah. I must trust him in the process. That's why my faith has to be living faith. It's walking faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. Hallelujah. Hey, glory be to God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. So Paul gets excited. He says, first and foremost, I thank my God. Hallelujah. Through Jesus Christ for you all, through that your faith is spoken of throughout the world. Glory be to God. Their faith did not just remain where it was. Their faith was not just Baltimore faith, but their faith spread it throughout. Hallelujah. The uttermost parts of the world. Glory be to God. Living faith, living faith, living faith, living, 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 living. Not stagnant, but living faith. All right, we about to close here. Give me about 8 more minutes. Here we go. Making requests, if by any means now, verse 9 rather, he says, for God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers. In my prayers, I make mention of you always in my prayers. Glory be to God. We need to continue in prayers for all people. Glory be to God. Even for those that are faithful, even for those that are faithful, hallelujah, in the gospel. Now, I know we think that some people are okay, some people are going through, but prayer should be made for all people, for intercessors, for people that stand in the gap, for the mourning women. We need to be praying for the deacons, for the ministers, for the pastors, for the elders. We need to be praying for the members of the church. We need to be praying for ushers, for doorkeepers. David said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper doorkeeper, praise the Lord, in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. We need prayers to be made for everybody. We need prayers to be made for every ministry, for the prayer band, even though they are a praying ministry. But we need prayers to be made for them that they can continue in faithfulness in prayer, in war, in spiritual warfare, standing on behalf. Glory be to God. We need prayers. We need prayers for the elderly. Glory be to God. For the same ones that prayed us over. Yeah. The same ones that prayed us over. And how many know that we're living through the prayers? Hallelujah. I know this for a fact. We're living through the prayers of our mothers and fathers and ancestors. And some of us are living through the prayers of our dead grandparents, our dead grandmothers. I know what I'm talking about right there. Glory be to God. Our deceased grandfathers, elderly, some of them gone off the scene, but they prayed for us. And watch this, God allowed their prayers to come up to him as a memorial. He stored them up. Glory be to God. Hey, God in vials, hallelujah. And what God does, he goes through the prayers, hallelujah, and he begins to answer them. And sometimes what happens is that we're living off of the prayers of what somebody prayed years ago. Somebody prayed for us when we were still yet in the womb of our mothers, hallelujah, and it's coming to pass. That's why you got to stay put and stay fighting. Glory be to God. Hey, even if you are a prodigal son, hallelujah, even if you think that you've gone astray, here it is, here's the revelation, that even when the prodigal son left, hallelujah, he had a mandate on his life. He had a calling on his life to come back home. Glory be to God. It doesn't matter how far we think we're going. Glory be to God. I know some people have backslidden, but why in the world do you think God says, I'm married to the backslider? God ain't give them no bill of divorcement. He's married to the backslider. So I want to tell somebody tonight loud and clear, wipe your eyes, wipe your tears. I know it look bad right now. Glory be to God. But you need to be comforted. Hallelujah. Then the word of the Lord, that no evil shall touch them. Glory be to God. That even though we got to remain, hallelujah, and understand that the seed that was sown is going to have to bring forth its fruit. Glory be to God. The seed that remains, hallelujah, and God is going to bless it. God's going to see it through. It's either, here it is, hallelujah, some may come through now, but I believe more may come through later. Hallelujah. And so God is going to give us a chance. Glory be to God. Tell somebody, I thank God for grace. Just type that in tonight. I've got to close here. I thank God for grace. Yeah, I thank God for grace. So don't you ever look down on anybody because they backslid. It's only because of I feel glory hitting me now. It's only by the grace of God that you and I remain who we are unto this very moment. Hallelujah. It's only by the grace of God. The Bible says, if it had not been for the grace of God, there go I. I would have gone. I would have left. I would have turned it in. I would have given up. I would have blown my brains out. I would have jumped off the cliff. I would have committed suicide. If it had not been for the grace of God, there go I. So what do you mean? It was not your intelligence. It was not your intellect. It was not your higher learning of education because, hallelujah, you passed the bar test. It was not because, hallelujah, you have the credentials and you had an A+ throughout high school and you garner credits, hallelujah, to go to college early, and they gave you, hallelujah, so many points to credits to graduate early. And some people didn't go through college for 4 years. Some graduate understudy, hallelujah, in 2 and 3 years, but they were that smart. But I want to tell somebody, this wasn't because of your intellect, it wasn't because of your ancestry, it wasn't because of your mother or your father, but if it had not been for the grace of God, hallelujah, I need you to type that in. I'm trying to quit, but I feel glory, hallelujah, about to explode in this place. Yeah. thing. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Tell somebody, if it had not been for grace, hallelujah, I would have been gave up. I would have been got a divorce. I would have been, hallelujah, jumped off the cliff. I would have been did something that make no sense. It's only by the grace of God. Therefore, we don't judge people. We don't kill people. We love them where they are. Hallelujah. If you see one overtaken in a fault, ye that think that ye are spiritual, restore them in the spirit of meekness. Here it is, lest ye also be tempted. And time and chance happens to them all. Hallelujah. So in other words, God allows seasons to come and seasons to go. Time and chance, time and chance, time and chance. Be careful of how you talk about people. Time and chance. If you're going to talk about them in the prayer room. Pray for them. Tell the Lord, bless them, keep them, strengthen them, make them whole, make their way perfect. Bless their children, bless their mind, bless their home, bless the school. Hallelujah. Bless them, bless their minds. Keep them back, bring them back, keep them back from presumptuous sins, and let them not have dominion over them. Hallelujah. God, I pray that you keep them and strengthen them. I got to close. We got to quit here for real. Hallelujah. But I feel glory. Hallelujah. He says, help me, Holy Ghost. He says in verse 12, he says in verse 11 rather, he says, for I long to see you that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end that you may be established, that you may be established. We need the word. Hallelujah. So Paul was desiring to see them, to come to them, to be with them. Glory be to God. I'm in verse number 11. He says to the bring the gift. He says to the end that you may be established. Hallelujah. Whoa, the word of God, the word of God, the word of God will settle us, establish us, and make our way perfect. That's why we need the word, the word, the word, the word, the word, the word, the word. We need the word. We need the word. We need the word. We need the word. And we got to hold on to the word. Hallelujah. Not only do we need the word, but we need to hear the word, and we need to love the word. We'll talk a little bit about that next week. Need to love the word that we hear. Glory be to God. He says, that is that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. He says that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith. Hallelujah. And you know we can encourage one another when we are in the same faith. Here it is. We're in the same faith. Hallelujah. While your faith may be at a higher level than mine, but you can encourage me to come on up a little bit higher. And so that's why we need to remain faithful in the congregation of the righteous. The Bible says, forsake ye not the assembling of yourselves together, because when we come together, somebody is going to be boldened. Somebody's going to be strengthened. Somebody's going to be helped. Somebody's going to be lifted. Hallelujah. Somebody's head that is hung low is going to be lifted up. Glory be to God. And then we'll lift up our eyes unto the hills from whence cometh our help. And we'll have the testimony that our help comes from the Lord. He says, now I would have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you, but was let hitherto. I was hindered. He says, I was hindered that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. He says, I'm a debtor both to the Greeks, which was a part of the culture. He says, and to the barbarians. He says, both to the wise and to the unwise. So Paul dealt with them all. Praise the Lord. To the wise, to the unwise, to the Greek, to the barbarians. Those that understood and those that maybe didn't understand as much. Those that are educated, because Paul was educated. So we don't condemn education. We salute education. Glory be to God. Why go through this life and and be foolish. Amen. It is wise to garner some sort of education. It helps us to succeed in the flesh. Yes, it does. And God will use that education mixed with his will and his spirit, hallelujah, to help us to find favor in other areas. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. And so he says, so as much as in me, as I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. So Paul was really willing to do God's will, and Paul desired to do God's will. Paul says, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Glory be to God. He understood, praise the Lord, his commandment from the Lord, that his obligation, he was mandated, he was commissioned to do this work, and Paul was willing to do the will of God in his life. Now, we must remain willing to do the will of God in our life. Now, verse 16 is where we're landing and we're closing. All right. He says here, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Listen to what Paul says. For it is the power of God. What is the power? The gospel. For I am not ashamed. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it, for the gospel, is the power of God. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. To everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. I say this and I'm closing. It's on the screen. It's important that we should never be ashamed of the gospel that he has called us to. Let me say this, and I say it quite frank, and I say it in love, but I say it strongly in a spirit of peace. Sinners are never ashamed of what they do. I mean, like, never. Therefore, as the children of God, we must be bold. We must be undaunted. And we must be audacious. We must be bold. We must be undaunted. And we must be audacious. It is this gospel that he says that is the power of God unto salvation. This gospel is so strong. It is so powerful that it takes people that are sinners, takes them from their sin, cleanses them, and will lead them all the way to heaven. All we got to do is believe. He that believeth and is baptized, he shall receive. In other words, so when you believe, if you're going to have a continuation in doing the work, when we believe, we're going to be fruitful in doing his will. This gospel is so powerful that it takes people from sin, sinners, and will cleanse them and lead them all the way to glory. Matthew 10, real quickly, Matthew 10 and Luke 12, real quickly, if you'll go with me, and I promise you, I know I said it four times, but I promise you we're closing right here and we're praying. Matthew 10 and 32, Matthew 10 and 32. Matthew 10 and 32. Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. Matthew 10 and 32. Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men. In other words, you're not ashamed of the gospel. Don't be ashamed. Be bold. Be audacious. Be undaunted. Yeah. Be strong in the Lord. He says, whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father, which is in heaven. Luke 12, real quickly. I want Jesus to confess me before the Father. That's what I want. I want the Lord to confess me before the Father, to say, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. He never denied me. He never denied me. So I want my sins, here it is, I want my sins to go before me. That's why we repent. That's why we repent. That's why we repent. That's why we need the door of repentance to always stay open. That's why you gotta repent. You gotta ask for forgiveness. There's no one person that's right all the time. We ain't never right all the time. Never. I mean, like, never. You show me that person is full of pride and ignorance. They don't know the Lord at all. And I don't care if they're in the church. They don't know the Lord at all. There's no way. Praise the Lord. All right? Luke 12, 9. But he that denieth me before men shall be denied before the angels of God. But he that denieth me before men, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God. What is the power? The gospel. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. This gospel is so powerful, it takes sinners, people that are in sin. Yeah, that was us. Cleansed us, purged us, washed us, wiped us up, and he's now leading us all the way to heaven. Keep on believing. Be strong in the Lord, soldier. The Lord is with us. Now, real quickly, Romans 1, verses 21 through 32. In your own words for next week, because I want you to type this in the chat room next week. That's your homework. I want you to type this in the chat room for next week. I want you to type in next week, not now, but next week, by the grace of God, unless we're going on to heaven, then we don't have to worry about typing anything. Glory be to God. But if the Lord tarries and we're still here next Friday, I want you to type in what you understood from verses 21 through 32. Your own understanding, your own revelation, what it meant to you. That's the homework for next week. And we will finish this chapter next week by the grace of God. Can we pray? Father, I thank thee. For certainly, it's only by your love and by your strength that we're here. The grace, the unmerited favor that you have allowed to be upon us. We know we don't deserve it, but certainly we want to be like the one leper to come back and tell you thank you. And Father, if we haven't thanked thee today as of yet, please forgive us, and please receive our thankfulness even now. I pray for my brothers, and I pray for my sisters. I pray the peace of God would be upon us. I pray for the joy of the Lord that is ever our strength. Pray for the hope yet does reside deep down on the inside. And we ask you, Lord God, for sons and daughters to come back home. Pray for prodigal sons and prodigal daughters and people that have been slaughtered by the hand of the enemy, people that have been maimed by the works of Satan, may come home confused and disarrayed. But God, I pray that you would help us to wrap loving arms around them, to be able to bind them up as they bind up the sheaves, and put them upon the shoulders and carry them to a safe place destination. Help us to be able to carry our brothers and sisters to the altar, to lead them, oh God, back to you, to pray with them, to fast with them, to love them for who they are. Help them to be healed even when they've been wounded. Father, forgive us of all sins and all manner of sins. And we pray for this nation. Pray for this world. We pray, Lord, for the wrath that is to come, that you would protect us, preserve us. Help us to ever keep our hand in your hand. And Lord, we know, according to your word, that we will not be plucked out of your hand. Thank you. According to the Old Testament, our names is written in the palm of your hand. Thank you. You are the King of Kings and you're the Lord of Lords. Continue to take us through this book of Romans. Give us revelation and insight, inspiration and hope, joy and peace. For this, we give you praise. We give you glory. It's in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. If you've never been baptized, my brother or sister, in the name of Jesus Christ, I want to offer you the chance to get baptized in the name of Jesus. You can meet us here physically, in person, where we will baptize you in the name of Jesus on this Sunday morning at 11 a.m. Glory be to God. Hands will be lifted. Songs will be sung. The music will be playing. People will be clapping. There will be a preached word. There will be prayers going on. The name of the Lord Jesus Christ will be lifted. Meet us here. We have clothes for both men and women. Yes. You got children? We have clothes for even boys and girls. We're willing to baptize you. Has to be in the name of Jesus Christ. For there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. The day you hear his voice, harden not your heart, as they did in the days of provocation. Give God a yes. Give him your best. Don't give him the rest, but give God a yes and make it your best. Until next week, we say we love you. We say God bless you. Peace be unto you. I'm Pastor Thornton. We love you in Jesus' name. Peace be unto you. Peace be multiplied.
Just throw your hands up in the air and receive it tonight. It's yours. If two or three are gathered in my name, I'll be in the midst of them. He's here. I feel him. Obianda bakosebe. Ramalio dalamasi anda bohosa. I feel him tonight.